as Ted said, you probably tired, but we are too, right? So I was planning to give this lecture yesterday, and then the AMO, which I did on Tuesday, actually today. But I thought then I'll leave you with a little wrong impression on so the capabilities of dynamical systems in looking at variability in the climate system. So today the lecture slides are again on the same link, and I put that in context again with the previous days. So again, at day one, we did this Hasselmann null hypothesis with the stochastic linear dynamical systems, and then we went to the problem of the Pleistocene ice ages, where we looked at simple transitions, so varying one parameter. And the idea was there that, well, you know, we didn't have a pattern of the Pleistocene ice age, variability, so we had a simple question just related to the, time series. And also, when we went to the Dansk-Gardusk oscillations, also was not so very ambitious, because we also looked at a particular time series, this ice core time series, and we looked at basically the interaction and the presence of multiple equilibria. And then basically here, where we looked at minimal models which you actually had to resolve a pattern, like the AMO and ENSO, we looked at the interaction of noise and internal oscillations, but still in this case, you know, in the minimal model, so the Kane-Ziebieg model and this, northern hemispheric thermal halo and overturning model, you still had one pattern which basically dominated, and which you could trace, actually, through the hierarchy of models. So that was much clearer for the ENSO than for the AMO case, but at least you had the idea that there's one pattern which actually is going to dominate, even if you're going to go to, say, eddy resolving ocean models, where this variability is also present. So this is very nice, but of course, now when you look at other phenomena, you know that might not be the case. And so today, I might end a bit on the negative side then, right? You know, I also want to show you the limitations of that sort of approach, and also then some recent ideas how to get out of there. How to use modern techniques to actually learn something about those systems. So that's the idea of today, and it's much less, you know, defined as the other days, because it's all material, also a particular later part which is still in development. So again, now the same, you know, diagram. You've seen it now many times, but after that you can forget it. This is, again, to focus, just now we go to smaller timescales. You know these things here, like QBO and Madden-Julian oscillation, and you know here also we're going to look at mid-latitude atmospheric variability. Those are, you know, much harder problems from dynamic systems point of view, and I'll show you also so why. But you can still, you know, try to do it. And what happens then, and that's what you see in the results later on, people, you can try to do that. So you can say, well, I take a conceptual model, so low in the hierarchy, or even a model like a zonal channel, quasi-deostrophic model, which I show also, which is a PDE, but you can still, you know, take that model, and then you can do dynamical systems analysis. But you already see very quickly, it gets hopeless. It gets really hopeless. I show you the results.
And then why?
Sorry?
Why?
Well, you see that. Yeah, I mean, I was just running ahead so to show you the context. And then you have to think about, well, what do we do then, right? Can we stop, or can we do something, you know, additional? So this is the aim, and, well, I switch out the sound, otherwise you get a lot of noise. So you've probably seen this movie, right, for mid-latitude flow transitions. I'm not exactly know what these data are in terms of, but it certainly is the jet speed, and at a certain height, it shows you this fantastic, you know, variability on the globe. But you probably see also this. You can just pick this from YouTube, of course, and you see already. Wow! If you look at this compared to ENSO, for instance, or compared to the AMO, this is a much richer phenomena to deal with, as you all know, and so. Well, to focus on particular, variability, you could do the NAO, you could do, you know, other, large-scale patterns of variability, but let's focus on blocking, just the blocking events, because there was much talked about also already by Ted also, and and as some of you are real experts in this also. And so this is the sort of what I learned from the climatology of blocking events. So you have about, 30 events a year in the Northern Hemisphere. They're persistent, 5 to 30 days. And these are typically, geopotential heights, which you see the high here. This is over Europe. You see Africa here, where you see this high, really omega-shaped jet around this high pressure system. So this is the typical cases here for the Atlantic and here for the Pacific. And it's important to make forecasts of blocking, because this is, I was just in Moscow 2 weeks ago, but luckily it was good weather. But here was the 2010 heat wave. And there you see, this is the same street. You see the photograph is a little taken from a little different, distance. But this is the situation in 2010, where you had this enormous, blocking and heat wave, and where you had these enormous fires. And it was difficult to breathe in Moscow. Yeah, this smoke. Yeah. This is from the fires which were around Moscow. And now, what happened then? Well, if you look at temperature anomalies here in the area, you see up to 5 degrees or so, and this is in July 2010, and you see also this enormous blocking here in the 500 hectopascal height anomalies. So this is also from July 10 to August 9 average in the area. And we know also quite a bit on blocking frequency. So here there's much known. There's a criterion for this. This is more operational, maybe a bit old-fashioned, but so it's still used a lot. Tibaldi and Multani, based on the geopotential height differences. And so if you look at the blocking frequency, and this is only from over this period here, July 1 to August 11, you see that, particularly here, you see high blocking frequencies. But 2010 was quite a top event also in terms of the blocking frequency. And if you look at the number of blocking days during July, also versus latitude, then you see also quite in this band, you see quite a bit of those blocking events. Yes? Blocking frequency is the time, over this period where you have blocked flows. So where this geopotential height criteria of Tibaldi-Multani is satisfied. So they just have a criterion on saying, you have blocking, yes or no. It's just based on a north-south and east-west geopotential height differences, which you can imagine if you look at the picture. You have to have high gradients in each direction. Okay. So now you ask the same questions, right? Naively, you'd say, I go to my Hayek-Iff models, and I can ask the question, do I have a preferred frequency there in my system? Do I have a preferred pattern in my system? And what minimum model do I need to use for answering that question? And if you think about it, and look at this time series, particularly, for instance, Ted showed the NAO. I mean, that's principally white, I would say, right? There is some high in the lower frequency. There is some, indication that you get a direction of red noise, but there's not a clear preferred time period or frequency in there. And if you go to a pattern, there is a persistent pattern here, but there's a lot of those patterns, and even the NAO looks like this pattern, and so it's very difficult to distinguish whether you have, from the observations, whether you have a very preferred pattern in there. So this is something you could aim for, but you immediately realize that you probably need, it's not sort of generated by one particular mode in the system, and you need to cover, a lot of interactions between different modes. So that already gives you the idea that you should be somewhere here, that you have to go into the more high resolution resolving models to actually do that. Of course, you can naively start with more, conceptual models, and people did that in the past. And let's do that and just see what happens then. So this is would be a minimal model for high resolution, where you go to, you've seen this before, the quasi-geostrophic barotropic vorticity equation, where you have a scale selective damping in there also to damp the high, frequencies, high spatial wave numbers. And this is, you put the forcing in from observations to get a reasonable mean state, details which are not so important for this whole story. A paper which did this, but there are many also other is from Frank Shelton et al. And many many others. And so this is what I call the minimum model as connected to the previous picture. And but you can do a different. You can say, well, I reduce it to a single channel. So instead of taking the say the full hemisphere, and this would be the equivalent then, just on the Bethe plane, same equations, just in local spherical, local Cartesian coordinates. And well, you can do a step further. You can say, well, I assume some expansion modes, or it could be Fourier modes in this case. And what I do, I truncate that. And this was done by, in this case, for six modes here, done by Dan Crommelin. But of course, there's also a famous Johnny DeVore model where you truncate in three modes, which is a subset of these equations. And you can see this as a dynamical system. You have a limited spatial pattern, so you have a limited number of modes here. So this is in zonal and meridional direction. And imagine these are just Fourier components, right, in the channel. So one is a zonal mode, one in the, and one here is the zonal mode in the meridional direction. And you can write down the equations just from Galerkin projection. Huh? Everybody knows that. I think you expand, you substitute in the equations here. And then you take the inner product of the residual with those expansion functions. And then you get the standard Galerkin expansion. You get a system of ODEs for this, say, for these modes. So you have a minimal, say, amount of modes which are interacting. And so also a limited amount of spatial structure. But this is, you know, this you can put it into matcont, dimension smaller than 10. And, you know, piece of a cake to compute bifurcation diagrams and look at instabilities. So Dan Crommelin did this. Yeah, I'll see that this afternoon. You're the group, right? Doing it. Yeah, one of them. Yeah. Or you can do it in auto. I mean, I recommend auto, but this is something you can easily do. Now you see there's a forcing components here. These come from, of course, from the forcing you put in here. So this is this forcing here. And in this case, you have two forcing components which are projected also on these modes. And you have these as you have a lot of other parameters, but you can take these as control parameters in the system and look at say what happens. Now this is a typical result from that model, that six mode model. So what is done? You fix the forcing ratio here, and you take the forcing here in x1 star. So that's the projection on the zonal one mode. You take that, you increase that, and you look at the response here at the x1. And then what you find is you find a back-to-back saddle node again. You know, as I said in day two, the bifurcations you can expect in when you have no symmetry and no obvious solution, which is a solution for all values of parameters, you see half bifurcations and back-to-back saddle nodes. And exactly here is what you see. You see the back-to-back saddle node bifurcations, which are also in the Charny-DeVore model. But then you have additional here, you have a half bifurcation, which is not in the Charny-DeVore model. And you have that too in this model, where this equilibrium state here, it basically, say, gets unstable through a half bifurcation. And you know that there's a periodic orbit somewhere here around. So how does the equilibrium look like? Well, equilibrium one is a zonal flow. So in the bottom, there's a topography, which is just a cosine form. So that gets into the equation here, right? This H here is just a cosine form. I sketched it here, but didn't write the form. It's just a cosine in these models. And so one is a zonal flow here. This is the stream function. This is reconstructed from x1 and from the other components. And then you have here an unstable steady state, which looks, more blocked. And then you have a blocked flow here, which is the equilibrium 3 in this case. And so you see that you have three equilibria, and you attempt to sort of associate that this transition between zonal and blocked flows are transition between equilibria, just as you would do for the Dansgaard-Ertz oscillations and transition between the Mach. Right? This is what you could conclude, and what you see also is that you have a half bifurcation here, which is barotropic instability, which you find in this model, and so you have also the instabilities here, which are temporarily and give you variability in the flow. Once you go above, say, this x1 is about, x1 star is about 8. So this is the result, and this mechanism on why you get these different equilibria is well known, and which you all probably know, this topographic instability or resonance, which is already in the Charney-DeVore paper. So basically the resonance between a stationary mode and the topography, which is amplified, and which can give you transitions between, say, the zone and blocked flow. So in that sense, very, very similar to the salt advection feedback, which caused also this change in the mark, you have this mechanism causing change between both flows. So this is the picture you get from the low order model. Okay. Well, you can go a bit step further to look at whether you get very low frequency variability in there, even in a deterministic case. So this is actually the same six mode model. And you see already that you have a hop and you have a settle node, and you know, when I change another parameter in the system, which is in this case the ratio of the forcing, this R, then what you can, I can sort of make a path of this hop and settle node intersect, and then as I showed you before, then you can get this sort of interaction, you get this global bifurcations. So in this case, that leads to heteroclinic orbits, so orbits which connect the equilibria but give chaotic behavior. And you see this, here, this R, when you change, you see this collapse here. It occurs actually here somewhere around 0.7, minus 0.9. And you get this variability here, which is low frequency variability here in the time series, where you get indeed these switches between, say, these two zonal equilibria and the blocked equilibria. So this is nice, right? You'd say, well, from that point of view, it's nice to actually, you get these transitions and you have a clear mechanism, this topographic instability and the barotropic instability, and they give you, say, this low frequency variability. Now, there's all kind of problems with this. I mean, if you look at parameter ranges where you find the realistic variability, they're outside, you know, the realistic ranges. And so what you can do is, well, you know, to improve that, you go to a two-layer shallow water model. And so that was done by one of my PhD students, just as an extreme continuation exercise. And so we took the two-layer shallow water models, took also an expansion in basis functions, and truncated it at 46 modes. So you include all kind of zonal and meridional modes, and also barotropic and baroclinic instability. And you're just curious how the bifurcation diagram looks like then. Well, yeah.
Do you use topography?
Yeah, topography also. This is just a cosine type topography in the channel, just the extension to, you go from QG, I won't show the equations because you know shallow water models. I just want to show you how hopeless it is. And it's not on the screen yet. Yeah. So you truncated at 46, you know, that somehow, that's of course not resolving, you know, a limited amount of modes, but you have, at least you have barotropic and baroclinic instability, and you have, you know, quite some wave interactions in the channel. And then I cannot even show you bifurcation diagrams itself, because you know, it's quite complicated. But what you'd like to know is how the paths of those bifurcations, how they vary with topography height and zonal mean jet velocity. So that's the two parameters, right, which play a role also in Charney and DeVore. So you have the height of topography and the zonal jet strength, which is your background flow. So you follow that bifurcations in that two-dimensional plane, and then you get this picture. So this means, yeah, so there's even a table, you know, to show what is what. So the green ones are settle node bifurcations, the red ones are hop bifurcations, the magenta ones are what I call torus bifurcations, so there's this transition where you have this Floquet multiplier going through the sort of unit circle, but not with 1 and minus 1. And then you have gray, you have peer doubling bifurcations, that's the Floquet multiplier going through minus 1. And then you have a blue, which is a saddle node bifurcation of a periodic orbit, so that means a hop fault, or a periodic orbit that goes through a saddle node, right? We discussed that too. So these are the type of bifurcations. And so this says that if you fix, say, let's take H0 is 1200 meters or so, you go through one saddle node bifurcation here, so that's a, and then you go through another saddle node bifurcation here, so that would be, you know, your original Charney and DeVore type of behavior. But you see there's a whole spaghetti of all kind of transitions where you go through half bifurcations here, there's torus bifurcations where this periodic orbits destabilize, there's peer doubling bifurcations here, And well, you know, what do you do with this to interpret what happens, right? But this is an exercise. Now, for the people who did something in auto, you know, you can do that in a few days. You have the whole thing done with 46 degrees of freedom. It's not a lot of work. It's just, you know, carefully monitoring what happens and compute all those bifurcations. Now, there's also a lot of codimension 2 bifurcations. So that's the intersections of, say, codimension 1, so elementary bifurcations. So you see degenerate Hopf and Hopf-Hopf. This means that two Hopf bifurcations collide. You have a Bogdanoff-Tychus, where there are two stationary bifurcations, so this is just a two degeneracy of real eigenvalues. So that's basically, you know, two saddle knots which collide. You have here a Hopf saddle knot collision and whatever. So those are also here, and they give you locally all kind of complex behavior. So you expect that as you go, you know, in either direction, you get quite complicated behavior. Now, okay, fine. So what you do is you try to compute Lyapunov exponents just to see how complicated this flow is going to get. And so you do that, and that was also done. And this is the diagram you get in this range. So also here you need a color coding. Green is just you have an equilibrium. Blue is your periodic orbit. Then you have magenta, you have a two tori which are there. And then in the cyan one here, you get chaos because you have one Lyapunov exponent which gets positive. And so you see this is the blow up of this picture here. You see how complicated this gets. And this is carefully computed. This is the Lyapunov exponents. You know, there's all kind of, you have to be careful in computing those. These are done with Taylor integrators and very carefully numerically. And so this is this fine structure of, you know, where you have chaos. And in the white areas, it's difficult to compute those, say, Lyapunov exponents. So they're not plotted. So this is the fine structure. And there's a lot of spatial patterns that you can, of course, associate with this because you can translate them back. But you see, it becomes actually hopeless to learn something about, you know, the original problem in terms of blocking and preferred frequencies, I would say. Yeah.
So in this problem, U0 is an external parameter?
Yes, external parameter is just the jet strength in the two-layer shallow water model, and it's only the upper layer flow.
Okay. Yeah. Because we may think of it as in the actual flow as being the result of another, I don't know, the difference of heating or the winds.
Yeah, but here in this model, you know, it's the same as what you do in Charney and Devoy. You just prescribe a jet in the background, and you just look at, you know, the variability around that jet. And U0 is just the background state. Of course, your mean is going to be modified, you know, enormously here in this regime by just the variability in the system. And these are many modes interacting, giving you this chaos type of behavior. So yeah, this is nice for Physica D, right? Showing you, how chaos appears, and there's a lot of analysis there in terms of the patterns and whatever. But it's not very helpful in terms, for instance, how would you understand where the pattern comes from blocking, for instance, for the block funnel throw transitions? This is already a very difficult question because it is resulting from multimodal interactions. Preferred time scales is very difficult too, because, you know, this chaotic is very wide spectrum basically, so it's very difficult to do that. So another question you could say, well, can I learn from this in terms of predictions? Can I make blocking predictions from this? Well, you know something about the Lyapunov exponents, so something about predictability horizons, but really devising a scheme or so to have an early warning of blocking or so is also not so trivial from this type of results, although you might have an idea to do that. So this is motivation that, well, you know, you're not, say, if you go back to the minimum model, which would be this northern hemispheric type of model, you shouldn't look at low order, you know, truncations and basically look at, say, bifurcation behavior just as we did for the elementary transitions. So you have to do something else. Is that clear so far? Yeah, that's also done in the paper. It shifts, you know, it shifts the positions of these bifurcations, etc. But it's the same spaghetti in terms of complication.
It's not a
No. If you would add twice as number of the modes, right, this would all shift in parameter space. Because there's no convergence you can show for that. No, that's also a problem. And it was just an exercise to see, you know, what kind of behavior you get. And it's not going to be simpler. This is somehow also, it's going to only become more complicated. So I think he did also double, and then you see even more structure. Which you see also when you look at box models in the ocean fence, and you look at two boxes, it's simple. If you look at 20 boxes, it gets very complicated. Now, this is a bit ad hoc model. This is, of course, truncation. But I think it, to get converged, to look at convergence here is quite a study. Can be done, of course. So if you look back at your minimal model, people have actually done try to look at number of fixed points in this model, so northern hemispheric barotropic vorticity equation, and Dan Comlin did it. And here, this picture here, when you this is a say projection of the say the flow of the system, so from that model, and then projected into the EOF1 EOF2 space. So again, for EOFs, for you take a long time series of the model. What you do is you look at the covariances, in this case of the stream function, and then what you do, you look at the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the covariance matrix, and those are eigenfunctions, are your EOFs, your eigenvalues explain the variance explained by this particular EOF, and then the PC1 and PC2 are basically projections of the time series on these modes. So you have the temporal signature of that pattern. And you get a, when you look at this, say, probability density, so a histogram of states within this PC1, PC2 area, you get a sort of bimodal type distribution where you have a region here where you have high probability, here you have a region which has also higher probability and there's lower probability in between. And Dan Comlin here plotted also with a technique to look at the fixed points of that model in this resolution. So this was a T21, I didn't forget that, a T21 truncation of this hemispheric model has about 250 degrees of freedom or so. So it's not that high dimensional, but much higher than the 46. And what you see is that you have many fixed points. These are all the crosses, and these are all fixed points. And the label here indicates how many unstable eigenvalues they have. And cross is 1, and this is 2 and 3. So they're very high, you know. If you look at the stability of those, they have very high number of eigenvalues which are positive, which means that they are unstable to many different modes. So this also shows you that in that model, it's fairly hopeless to look at, you know, bifurcation behavior from the low order point of view. And also this Legrand-Gill, Michael mentioned that quickly on Tuesday, but they also did this first for actually this model also in a bit lower truncation. They also find a lot of those, say, different fixed points and very difficult to interpret, you know, what the flow is actually doing with it. Now, what Dan Comlin also found, and this is what we're going to expand on, is that if you look at, say, how the transition paths are from the zonal to the blocked flow, because these are, I showed that later, these are really zonal and blocked flow type of patterns. I show the patterns in a minute, so I can better. It's not pure zonal block flow, it's also a mixture of with the NAO and the Arctic oscillation in this thing. It's much more complicated, but at least this you can sort of attribute this to a more blocked flow, and this is a more zonal flow. And that you find that always when you go from the zonal flow to the blocked flow, it actually takes a transition path that goes through this sort of more negative value of PC3. So that would be the EUF3 pattern for negative amplitudes, which would be sort of every time you go through this particular region. And so this makes it if you want to look at predictability, and particularly also when you want to have sort of a predictor indicating that a blocking event is occurring, this is where you, in this highly heavily chaotic system, is where you maybe find some predictability, right? It's preferred paths. And so this is where we're going to sort of, where we try to expand on. And so what you can do is you can look for a even reduced model where you take, EOF as a basis, and these are the, I show them later also, these are decorrelation times, so you really see that there are many of those. I show them later also, they're not well separated in time. And well, we try to sort of expand on that. You have some some meta stability here what is called in the literature, and preferred transition paths. So now the you focus only now on the statistics of the flow, keeping this sort of picture in mind. And now we're going back to dynamical system theory, because we have, you know, we only exploited all those techniques. So we looked at elementary transition. This is the picture I put up in day one. You look at normal modes. We looked at briefly at global bifurcations, transitions to chaos. I didn't touch on the inertial manifolds, but we looked at synchronization in ENSO yesterday. So these are the elementary, say, low order type methods. But there's also another part which basically is involved with, you know, long-term behavior of ensembles of trajectories, and this is more statistical approach to basically what happens in these flows. And it involves invariant measures. Michael talked a bit about that, transfer operators, evolution of correlations. So what is this about? Well, this is, I'll introduce that basically by looking at a two-dimensional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. Remember, we did the Hasselmann, which is a 1D Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. Here we have a two-dimensional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. You see it's a linear here in, say, in P1 and Q1. This is the particle in the heat bath problem. And this is, you specify only noise here in the position, basically here by Arena process. And don't worry about this coefficients and whatever. It's just the amplitude of the noise. So you're recognizing here just an Itô equation, two-dimensional. You have a matrix system here, and you have a noise which has only a component in one direction. And you can plot trajectories. Actually, you could do it with the software in your toolbox. You just extend it to 2D. You take actually the half bifurcation, stochastic half bifurcation MATLAB code, and you modify it easily to do this computation. Now, you can do that for, a lot of, initial conditions. So here is this is the boundary here where P1 is 0. So there's a negative P1, positive P1. And then you integrate all these trajectories, and you integrate them in time, and you follow them. Well, the eigenvalues here are chosen that you have a negative eigenvalue, so it converges right to 0 if it were a deterministic system, but the noise, of course, keeps it in an equilibrium, and like the normal Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. And then what you see is you see they mix, right? ST is the flow, so ST is nothing mysterious. If you have the system, n-dimensional system, x dot is ax, right? You all know that xt is a solution. It's e to the power ta times x0. So st x is just e to the power ta x. It's just the flow of the system in this linear case. And you can do that more generally, of course, when you have nonlinear systems also. But here in this case, it's very easily defined. And well, you want to learn something about how that actually mixing, how that occurs. Now, there's one thing I have to mention now, although I'm not going to use it too much, but here this concept of ergodicity comes in. When you go to, say, t to infinity and look at the density of these trajectories, you see that they actually, and this is in the picture, they actually converge to a sort of equilibrium density, and you can call that rho infinity. So in the Fokker-Planck, setup we did, you start with an initial distribution, which was this one here. You just follow the density with the Fokker-Planck equation. This would be the stationary distribution of the Fokker-Planck equation, just the PS. And then you can, the ergodicity hypothesis is basically that if you integrate, say, over the, say, equilibrium density, an observable G, that eventually that's the same as taking, the limit of a long time series and integrating over that time series. So this is the ergodicity hypothesis. Now here the system is ergodic. Of course, that also system is not ergodic, because you might not visit all part of the attractor. But this is the ergodicity. And well, what is interesting to look at here in this two-dimensional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process is to look at how the correlations evolve. So for instance, when I look at the correlation Q1, Q1, so just the autocorrelation of Q1, then I can write that down like this, right? I look at t going to infinity. I look at the correlation. I subtract the variance there if and g are the same, and then what I get is I get mixing. This correlation gets to 0, and what I see is if I plot this correlation for this system, I see that there's an oscillatory component, right? which is basically I see also as a peak in the spectrum. And there's also a decaying component, which is basically the rate at which the system mixes. So this is the real part of this lambda. And you can compute this lambda explicitly here for this system. This is also not an exercise in the lab, but for a different system, for a one-dimensional OU, or Ornstein-Ollenberg process. You can compute this basically this decay of correlations here, you can compute them separately. And I'm going to show you how to do that, because that's relevant also for the rest. So this is called a mixing spectrum, showing you how this, say, correlations decay, and if they're oscillatory, where you have a peak in the spectrum. So what's this theory about? Well, you have basically, say, the Fokker-Planck equation. I showed you this. Now, if you have no noise, it's called the Liouville equation. So you can do that also for deterministic systems. And how does that look like? Well, basically, there's an operator here which basically propagates, say, the densities. And we all saw the 1D Fokker-Planck equation, which we used for the Ornstein-Ullenberg process, where you had this, and this was minus gamma x, right? And this was just sigma. And basically, this is the generalization to n dimensions of this Fokker-Planck equation. Yeah, I hope you, that's also in the notes in section two. And this is then the diffusion tensor. Now, this also has, and I showed it in the notes also, this also has an adjoint, which is called the backward Kolmogorov equation. And so the adjoint in the standard inner product in L2. And you can show that this adjoint, and it's explicitly, I have no time to do that on the board, explicitly given by, you know, you see the Fi here taken out and the Dij is taken out, so it looks very similar, but it's just another equation, which is the backward Kolmogorov equation. This is also sometimes called the Kolmogorov operator or the generator, and it will play a role in terms of computing this mixing spectrum. So now, what is now the basically the idea? The idea is that basically, if you have this Fokker-Planck equation, then you have an initial density. Then basically, this rho is transported by an operator, right? It's a linear equation, the Fokker-Planck equation. So it's transported by an operator, basically in time. So you could see this e to the tk. You could see that at, you know, at how the probability density function in time evolves under the action of the sort of the operator k here. And when you look at correlation functions, you can basically define it in this way, as I did before. Now, I have here, in general, when you have a general measure and not a, in this case, an equilibrium probability density function, you write that basically this rho infinity dx, you write it as mu dx. But it's, you know, it's mathematical detail, so I don't think it's important for this whole story. And what you can do, you can actually define also an adjoint operator to this transfer operator, and that's called the Koopman operator. And you have to remember that basically the transfer operator, it propagates densities in time. The Koopman operator, it propagates observables in time. You see that also here. It basically gives to an observable here, it shows you how it propagates in time under the flow of the system. And it's very much used in techniques like dynamic mode decomposition, which is used in turbulent flows and whatever, that's basically exploiting this aspect of the Koopman operator. But that's not what I wanna expand on, because then otherwise it gets too long. Now, this Koopman operator is basically an adjoint of the transfer operator. And to show that a bit visually, you see when you compute these correlations, you have here fx, transported under the transfer operator to this LT here, and then you take the integral over this, say, area here, gx and LT fx. So that's one form of the this form here of the correlation function. And it's similar to what you do as if you basically, say, transport g under the flow, so here gtx, and you take the overlap here with fx. Now, the picture's not very, very nice, but this should be the same as this one here, of course. So this is the relationship, how you can compute, say, correlations based on transfer operators or based on the Koopman operator. So is LT acting on the product of FG, FNG, or? No, LT is operating on F here. Yeah, it's, there's no, usually they would put brackets there, but yeah. You're fighting on it. Okay, you know. Oh, okay, good. Yeah, then your director doesn't approve. Okay, good. So now, what do you want to do? Well, basically, what you want a spectral decomposition of this transfer operator, and this you can do. You can actually look at the eigen, say, functions of the transfer operator. They're time dependent here. The eigenvalues are time dependent. And also you can look at the eigenvectors of the Koopman operator. So this is basically, and you can show that these are the adjoints, because you know, or the complex conjugate, because it's the adjoint, say, operator. And now you have a theorem, which is, yeah, you know, you have to look that up to understand that. The Engel and Nagel, say, spectral mapping theorem, which says that if you look at the eigenvalues of the generator, so it comes from the backward Kolmogorov equation, you have those eigenvalues lambda k that the eigenvalues of the transfer operator here, they're related by an exponent. Now this is the basic, say, mathematical theorem, where you can relate, say, lambdas, so these are basically monitoring the decay of correlations, you can, say, relate them to basically to the eigenvalues here of the transfer operator. Yeah, it's a little difficult, huh? Well, actually, no, yeah, you don't have to understand that now, but it's a lot of in the notes to get sort of the more information on it. Now, what can you do now? You can actually write down the correlation function by the spectral decomposition. You can write it as an expansion in those eigenfunctions, and then you can project, and you get here this say expression of the correlation function in terms of these eigenvectors. So you see this e to the power lambda kt. Now what does this mean? You see a case 2 is missing here, which means that you have an eigenvalue here lambda 1 is 0, which basically said that, you know, there's a distribution here, psi k, which is invariant, and that's basically your equilibrium density. Because when you propagate the probability density function in time and you're in equilibrium, well, then you have the same value, right? So there should be an eigenvalue 1 there in this transfer operator. And that's basically given here. So L has an eigenvalue 1. And this basically gives you that you have this lambda 1 is 0 because it's exponentially related. And because you have decay of correlations, you see that all the eigenvalues of this, say, generator, they have to be in the left half plane. So you see you have always an eigenvalue, say, 0 here for lambda, which is the invariant, say, probability density function, or the invariant measure in more general. And then you see here that you have basically these eigenvalues here, they're going to control how your decay is going to be of your correlations. So the real parts will give you this exponential decay, right? Look at the particle in the bath where you had this exponential decay. And the imaginary parts will give you oscillatory behavior, so it'll give you peaks in the spectrum, right, of the variability. Now what is important is this spectral gap here, which is basically the distance between the zero and the first eigenvalue, the real part of the first eigenvalue, because that says, you know, that's the dominant contribution of how the correlations decay. So this delta here, and it's given by minus the real part of this lambda 2. So this is how this sort of theory on operators and transfer operators and eigenvalues is built up. Yes.
What is lambda 2?
Yeah, lambda 2 is the second eigenvalue. So you see here the lambda k were the eigenvalues of the generator. So here you have lambda 1, right, which is 0, and then you have lambda 2 is here.
They're sorted in decreasing order.
Sorted in real part, yes. So lambda 2 is the one, you know, dominantly controlling that's the slowest decay rate. Yeah. So any higher eigenvalue here is basically giving you a higher decay rate. Good. Well, you still think, what can I do with this? Well, let's see that. So you can actually do the Fourier transform of the correlations to get the spectrum. And then you get this picture. You get some kind of linear combination with this weighting here, depending on your observations of this particular, say Lorentzian spectrum. This looks like much like this sum of this Hasselmann type of spectra, right? And then what you see is that you have here this picture. Every time you have a real part, every time you have an imaginary part, you get a peak in the spectrum. And say decay rates are, as I said, are given by this minus, say, real part. And so the summary of this whole exercise is that this, when you determine the mixing spectrum, it tells you a lot about slow parts in the flow and fast parts in the flow related to decay of correlations. Yeah, I hope that gives you a bit of intuitive feeling for what this does. So this mixing spectrum is very important. So these are also called Ruelle-Polycot resonances. There are all kind of different words for this, but we call it just the mixing spectrum. Now, what can you do with this? Well, first show you some examples for the stochastic half bifurcation. And actually the code, I realized for the groups who had to do lab 5, where they actually compute the mixing spectrum of one of the cases mentioned there, I think there's also stochastic half bifurcation. It's not so easy without this lecture, I know that, but I saw people already reading ahead. And the calculation is easy. You just push the button and you get the answer. But then you have to know what it means, of course. So this is the mixing spectrum when you go from, you have a stochastic half bifurcation, so you have Q is 0.5 here, so that's the, actually there's two normalizations, but you take the amplitude the same. And this is the mixing spectrum when you get to mu is minus 10, so that's very in the simple, in the stable regime, where you see correlations strongly decaying. And now watch what's going to happen when I increase mu. So I go from mu 0 here, you know, you go through the transition deterministically, you get through the half bifurcation, and this is how the spectrum changes. So you see mu running, you see it really changes meridional, a fundamental structure, and then it splits out when you get to, say, the supercritical case. So you see here that basically you get a lot more, say, eigenvalues here near the, say, near the imaginary axis. So what does that hint to? Yeah, more peaks, exactly, you know. You see a lot of variability induced in this case, which you see due to the supercritical nature where you get these fluctuations. So this gives you a glimpse on the mixing spectrum. Now, this people, Jaspar and Nicoli, and they did all this work on computation of mixing spectra for saddle knot bifurcation, pitchfork, half bifurcation, and also more complicated ones. There's a book by Jaspar which basically summarizes that all, and I put a little bit of that in notes. They do it through trace formula, which is a very nice method, which I don't explain here, to determine this, because you can actually relate, you know, you can formulate a representation of this transfer operator in terms of delta functions, and you can use trace formula to basically compute them. It's in the notes, so you see a bit how that works. And I compute this, you can put this analytically, but you can compute also easily numerically. Maybe you ask a question first.
So we're looking at these lambda k, and these are what you call the mixing spectrum.
Yes.
Could you motivate that name? Because I...
Well, because it says how quickly the system mixes. And remember this two-dimensional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. Actually it was mixing to an equilibrium state eventually. The correlations function goes to zero. And this decay, you know, this real part of the lambda was basically giving you the decay rate. And so that's basically, it shows you aspects of the mixing.
So when the correlation decays, that's what we call mixing?
Yeah, when it goes to zero.
Thank you.
Yeah. There's a more mathematically, you know, stricter formulation, but that's somehow, I think, intuitively that's
just
good.
Just to add, I think it might help to mention that this spectrum is usually used a term to denote the set of all eigenvalues.
Sorry?
It's probably good to just point out that spectrum is a term used to denote the set of eigenvalues of the object.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, well, yeah, the spectrum is differently used. But you know, in the context, is usually clear. If you say spectrum of an operator, you know eigenvalues. Spectrum of a time series, you have a. So that's basically hopefully clear. So this is and how you compute them. Well, you know, there's an easier method numerically, at least in principle. You can solve just the Fokker-Planck equation in time. Yeah, in a minute.
Could you explain what the sine of mu means physically?
Oh, okay, yeah. You know, mu, for instance, in the Enzo model, in the Enzo view, where we had stochastic half bifurcation, mu is just the amplification factor of temperature anomalies. So this is just controlling the instability. So you easily see that here by linearizing. Yeah, I didn't do that. Or maybe I should have done that on Tuesday. So you see, if you linearize, you get dx tilde dt is equal to mu times x minus omega y tilde. And when you take the dy tilde dt you get here, you get, say, omega times x tilde plus mu times y tilde. Now you easily see when you look at the eigenvalues of this matrix, right, that they have a, they go through the imaginary axis at mu is zero. You just take the eigenvalues, so mu minus lambda here, mu minus lambda, and then you get minus omega, omega here. You take the determinant and you get mu minus lambda squared plus omega squared is equal to zero. And you see the eigenvalues are mu plus or minus I omega. And so they go through the imaginary axis at mu is zero. Yeah? Where you go from a damped oscillation in the orbit view to a sustained, to a limit cycle. Good. But remember, those eigenvalues are very different than those eigenvalues, right? These are the eigenvalues of, you know, controlling the linear stability of along the orbit, in this case a fixed point. Whereas here, you know, this is measuring the statistics of the system. It says something about a decay to the equilibrium probability density function of a whole ensemble. It's very different, these eigenvalues. Okay, so when you look at, say, this mu is minus 5, and you don't consider the crosses here, that's sort of a small noise approximation, but not relevant here. So what you basically look at the dots here, this is the say mixing spectrum at very large negative mu. You see indeed that there are hardly any peaks in terms of spectra of, you know, in this case of x itself, x squared and x to the third. And when you look at, say, the eigenvalues for mu is 3, you get indeed, you get these dominant peaks here for the eigenvalues nearer to the imaginary axis with a, and this kind of, and we just see sub-peaks already here too, and some of the higher order statistics. So again, you can relate, say, peaks in the spectrum of these variables, you can relate them to these eigenvalues of the, in this case, the generator. Now, what do we do with that in the minimum model? Because there you have, you know, you have 250 degrees of freedom. So if you want to solve the Fokker-Planck equation, 250 spatial dimensions, that's hopeless. So you cannot do anything. So you have to do reductions. And so what you can do is that you take a... so again, I this is summarized, you know, the same model. You take a very long simulation, 500,000 days. And to just have an enormous set of long trajectories which go, you know, through the different stages from, say, from different patterns. And then, well, you... this is just to show you that if you look at the model mean, it's not, you know, it's not ridiculous. And if you look at, this is actually the standard deviation. So this is, and this is from observations, I showed earlier. And then you look at the EUFs. So these are the three EUFs. This is already in the model by Selton. Three EUFs, which basically, this looks, has features of, you know, blocking here and the Arctic oscillation. This one is less clear. And this one has features of the NAO. You see here the negative phase of the NAO, where you have basically you have this, say, dipole structure over the Atlantic. And if you look at, say, the decorrelation times, so this the dots here, well, you see they're not so not so well separated, right? This is it. So if you look at how many EUFs you would like to include to reduce, and you would like to, you know, compute, say, transfer operators, you go maybe to three dimensions, but that's already quite expensive, so you prefer two dimensions. You have to make a choice, basically, whether you take EUF 1 and 2, or EUF 1 and 3, or EUF, you know, 2 and 3. But you'd like to include EUF 1 at least. And so what is done is we did both. I mean, we did, say, EUF 1 and 2, EUF 1 and 3, and, of course, also EUF 1, 2 and 3. But I'll show you the results for EUF 1 and 3, because that's also, remember the results I showed you earlier by Krommelin, that's a long way back, but it's no problem. Here you see he had also this preferred path into the EUF 1, EUF 3 space. But you see also the same features when you do it in EUF 1, EUF 2, it's just less clear how to do that. Now, what do you do now? You have to make an estimation of this transfer operator. And these are where the set theoretic methods from Delnitz and Junge, and they have this package GAIO, which you might know, which really looks at, say, how say, volumes transfer along a flow. So what you do is you define an observable, and then you have this grid of boxes. So you take this two-dimensional space, PC1, PC3, you put a grid over it, and then basically what you do is you look basically at the transition probabilities. So here you compute the transition probability that you're with the observable, you're in the box Bj at a later time tau, under condition that you were at tau say t tau at zero, you were at the box Bi, and this gives you transition probabilities, and it basically says you how probability is transferred, say, over this two-dimensional space.
So here your H is of the PC1 and PC3.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so
it's
from this shallow water model or from
data?
Yeah,
this is from the minimum model. So this is just from a hemispheric barotropic model. And this model here, where you compute the EOFs here. So it's the same. We stuck with the minimum model from now on. And well, you can. This is an approximation of the transfer operator, of course reduced into this two-dimensional space. And well, you can compute eigenfunctions of this LT, and you know there must be an eigenvalue 1, because that's the invariant probability density function, and it looks like this on a 50 by 50 grid. So basically you see this similar to what if you do it naively, make a histogram, you get here the, say, the high probability for the zonal flow, which is more, and here you get say the lower, but also still say a sub-maximum in the probability here, which is the blocked flow, which has in this case a stronger negative, say, PC1 component. Remember, PC1 was the arctic oscillation and blocking, and here you see really basically the two PC1 have different sign, and whereas PC3 is here mostly positive in those maxima. So this is the distribution you find, and of course you have to test this, and you know this is a quite robustness. You have to check the number of say grid points and whatever, but it's all being done 100 by 100, 200 by 200, and whatever. And that 50 by 50 is reasonably converged in terms of the equilibrium density and the transition probability matrix. So this is this technique, you know, how people trace also plastics through the ocean, right? You look at you could do a what people did before was, well, you know, you take a high resolution ocean model. Actually, I was that naive also doing that, and you put plastic particles in where you think the plastic goes into the ocean, and then you compute, you know, your trajectories based on, you know, the velocity fields you get from the ocean model. So that's quite a but what you can also do, and this is much smarter, is that you actually compute this say transfer operator in a, basically you can do it from drifted data. You look at, say, how tracers went from one place to the other. You compute this transition probability matrix, and then just iterate over the transition probability matrix, and you find the distribution of the plastics, you know, with one in a few seconds, because it's only matrix vector multiplication. So this is really a technique by Dell and Jung, and also exploited by Freuland and other people to do this kind of, say, propagation of probability. Now, there's one drawback here, and what is this? Yeah.
So for the plastic thing you mentioned, you will have to multiply multiple number of times so that it converges to the largest.
Yeah. Well, you know, I have a bit of time, I think. I didn't prepare this, so, but I know the guy who's doing it, because we just hired him in the department. He is still here, and we stole him from Imperial. I know, yeah. he probably has a tracking of plastics in the sea. Ah. No, that's his ESC project. Oh, gosh. Now I have to. Oh, yeah, here it is, Adrift. Good. So this is the plastic Adrift, and how did it end up? You have to click somewhere. So I think you'll release, well, Indonesia has a lot of plastic usually. So here's the, you put a rubber ducky there, and then just integrates, you know, integrates in time how this plastics, how that moves over time. This is all done with a transfer operator approach. And, yeah.
We do have some means for the
No, yeah, this is it's done. You know, the underlying transfer operator is constructed from drifters data, so and it's assumed that you have this stationary flow in the background. Yeah, yeah. You know, yeah. When everything gets non-stationary in terms of you have a transient forcing, you get everything like climate change. It's much more difficult to do this kind of things because you have a non-autonomous background system. Well, you know, do it yourself. You can actually click on many other Derby Duckies, I think, and see how they develop. It's just fun. It's for kids, this. But the underlying technique is actually very, very interesting. Good. So this gives you an idea. And I said, what's the drawback here? So I do projection. Now I put a light on. What's the drawback? So when you think, I write down something. Suppose I have a linear system, ax plus by, and I have y dot is cx plus dy, right? And now imagine I have this 250 dimensional system where the trajectories live, and now I project them all in the, say, the 2D space based on PC1 and PC3. So I do a projection into a two-dimensional space. So I can do this, you know, easily. Say, well, I have two dimensions, and I project into the one-dimensional space. Right? So what do you get? Well, you can solve this. You all know how to do that. So the yt, you know, the homogeneous solution is equal to e to the power, say, dt, right? So when cx is 0, and then I get my particular solution here. I get it as a function, let's say alpha t e to the power dt. And when I solve that here, this is just variation of constants, which you all know. I get here, say, alpha dot, and I get e to the power dt. Plus here I get, say, d times e to the power dt times alpha is equal to c times x. And I get here d times, in this case, alpha e to the power dt, and so this should cancel, because that's your variation of constants trick. And I see that I get my alpha dot here is equal to c times x times e to the power minus dt. And so when I have alpha, maybe do it here now, my alpha t is an integral, say 0 to t, and then I get c, and maybe make this explicit, x s e to the power minus ds. Ds. And so when I plug that solution for y, I plug that into x dot, I get here in the equation, I get x dot is equal to a times x, then I get b, and then I get this whole thing here. So I get e to the power, or I get an integral from 0 to t. Of course I have a y 0 here, but I take that 0. And then I get here, I get c times, then I get x s, and I get e to the power, and I shouldn't forget, and I get here s minus t or so, ds. Right, because I have to multiply by dt, and so I get t minus s. So this is the solution. Now what's the problem here? Yeah, but what do you, in physics, physical way? So this is what's happening when you project. Huh? This is the easiest thing you can do. And you see when you project, you get this type of equation. So you get memory in the system. You know, the original equations, the future state depends also on the state, the first state in the past, right? This is called Markovian property, which is also in the notes explained very well, but I didn't do much on it. So all the SDEs, the stochastic differential equations, they all have Markovian structure in Ito sense. And basically here you see that if you're going to project, and this is going to be in general, you get memory in there. And so although the original system has this, you know, semi-group property where you basically, what Michael also said, you know, this co-cycle property where you have, when you go from one to the other, and then to the next point, it's the same as going directly from one to the other, this might not be satisfied because you have memory here in the system. So this is a worry, and so you have to test for that. whether that is severe. Now the mixing spectrum gives you an indication, because you know if it actually is the if the projected system has actually not the memory, so this is relatively small, then the eigenvalues of the mixing spectrum, right, coming from the transfer operator, should be constant in time, right? Because that's the, say, Engel and Nagel theorem. It says, you know, the eigenvalues of the generator are the same as exponent of the transfer operator, but that's only under the condition that you have the semigroup property. So what you can test is you look at these eigenvalues. So these are the this is the mixing spectrum for this in the projected system. And then what you find is you find, of course, an eigenvalue 0, which is the invariant measure, so the invariant probability density function. And then you find a bundle of eigenvalues where the gravest ones, so these are with the slowest decay rates, right? Basically, they are constant in time, not totally, but they don't vary much in time. And so this indicates that if you go with this lag tau, which plays a role, so that's basically the time over which you construct this transition probability matrix, that if you make it, say, bigger than 8 days or so, that it's fairly constant in time, and that you hope, and you can test that also, that basically your, say, reduced system still has the semigroup property and that the memory is relatively weak. This is the idea behind it. So I see that it's difficult to, you know, to capture directly, but I hope you get a bit the idea that that these effects here are relatively small.
So yeah. What do you mean by constant in time?
I mean constant in tau.
Why
constant in tau?
Tau is what the
tau is the delay time
the delay.
Over which you construct, say, the transfer operator.
So you construct the transfer operator with different value of tau.
Different taus, yes.
And then you you compare the result.
And then you compare the result, exactly. Yeah. So this is basically the construction for the transfer operator, and of course computing the I for every value of tau, up till in this case 40 days. So this is limited memory effects, but of course, you know, they're limited, but they might be there, so you can do the test. And so what you do, you take an initial density, and then you take, you repeat that, say, k times over the timescale tau. So you apply that k times with this delay time tau. What you can also do, you can take basically, say, k times the tau, right, and then compute also the density. So this is exactly the semigroup property which you test. And then you look at the differences. And this is two pictures for K is 2 and K is 4. So that basically looks at, you know, different time frames. And then this looks bad, the red, but you know, that's the small values. So you see that in the transition areas and also in the states here, what you basically get is that you get relatively low values, say, of this difference, which means that memory effects are relatively small. You see them bigger here near the ends, but there, you know, you have hardly any trajectories, so that's not so bad. And this also, you have to, of course, the robustness test on, you know, how this depends on tau and whatever, but this looks pretty good in this EOF 1, EOF 3 space. Good. Now you have done this. Now you can actually, what you can do is define, you know, zonal and blocked states. So what you can do is say, well, I look at what do we call in almost invariant sets. So basically you look at, say, the set A, where if you, say, propagate that over time tau, under the condition that, of course, it was in at tau 0, it was in A, that probability is approximately 1. And there are all kinds of techniques to do that, basically to look at the invariant sets. Yeah, that's a long story. So it's not even in the notes. The best reference is Deng et al. Goes through. It looks a lot like in networks, how you compute communities. So there are algorithms to look for communities in networks. You know, all networks, right? You have a Facebook, you have a community, which is, you know, that's highly connected, and then there's low connections to other communities, and so you have to distinguish those communities that are, say, all kind of algorithms for. And this is this similar setup as you basically use for the almost invariant sets. Now you have to choose the number of that, and if you choose the number 2, it will define the space in 2, say, different sets. So these are the background here, zonal and blocked, say, sets, which are almost invariant. And of course, yeah, that fills up the whole space. So if you want to design something going from one state to the other state, it's best actually to restrict that to, you know, states where you actually say, well, the probability to stay, say, after 8 days in the zonal regime here is about 0.7. So you take a probability, which basically, in this case, it nearly halves the sets in volume compared to the original, say, division due to this almost invariant set decomposition. So that's a little technical, but what we want, of course, is now we want to design, once you have defined, so what is the zonal and block flows, you can set up a stochastic prediction scheme, right? You have an orbit here, it will leave the zonal flow, it will eventually go into the blocked flow, and what you want to do is have an objective criteria on the which it goes to the blocked flow. So you have to define these regimes in a more restrictive setup, and that's why we took this probability of 0.7 related to 8 days.
So you 8 days and 0.7 are both your choice?
Both choice, yeah, you could do that differently.
So I guess it depends on the dynamics of your model, what would be the best to use for these two numbers?
Yeah, that could be, but that's not what we sort of investigated, and you would have to change parameters or so and look whether that's going to be different. Yeah, that's not what we did yet. But this is something, this is somehow, you know, from now on it gets a bit fun instead of really important, I think. But it's just, you know, how can you set up a stochastic prediction scheme which give you a reasonable hit rate to go from one to the other state? So this is the problem you're going to deal with. So how you exactly do that in terms of the probabilities is not so essential. But you can just say these blocked and zonal flows, these are more objectively defined based on these algorithms. And then with these restrictions are, okay, that there's a choice there to make. Yeah. So first about this, say, transition paths. So what you can do is you can look from this old trajectories. Now, I think in the next slide I had how many trajectories there were. About 11,795. So that's quite a number of trajectories from this, you know, this big data set. And you can compute, say, the likelihood to reach, for instance, B before C. So here you start in trajectories and you look at, say, the probability for ending up in B here before you get to C. And this is going, this showing you that if you go from the zonal to the blocked flow here, which is now very well defined what this, say, states are in terms of the PC1, PC3 space, what you see is that this goes through regions where you have negative PC3, right? So this is confirming that you have this preferred paths in going from the zonal to the blocked flow. And now, once you know that now, you can set up a prediction scheme. Because you can say, well, I start in a certain initial box. I'll integrate, you know, forward with the transfer operator. I basically compute after, in this case, after 8 days. So this is the starting box. This just means the box 315, which is this one. You wait 8 days and you look at, you know, what's the probability of ending up in the state B just by looking at the overlap of this probability here with the state B. And then after 16 days, for instance, you find that it's 32% probability. And so basically that you can give an alarm, for instance, if you take that alarm for 0.3. You can take also 0.2 and 0.1, it's your choice what you take for alarm. But when you take it here, you can say set an alarm in terms of, say, how much probability you have in reaching, say, state B. And you can also look at the alarm time. So here you see that once you start in this box here and you take this critical probability 0.3, it will take about, say, 24 days to reach the state B. So this is also, you have also an average time over which when you give an alarm, how long it takes actually to get there. And so you see, of course, when you're in B, that time is zero. And here it gets longer when you get, say, along this preferred path going from the zonal state. So that gives you now a possibility to define this ROC type of approach where you look at, say, hit rates and false alarm rates, etc. And you have to set a tolerance time. because I give my alarm at say tau f, and I have my occurrence of the event say a little few days later, but I have to I'm satisfied with a certain tolerance time. I can be 1 day off, 2 days off, so that's the epsilon. So that's set here, and when I give an say alarm here, and I get a an occurrence, then I have a hit within this tolerance. So that's nice. That's the best thing. And of course, when I don't give an alarm here and I don't have a I don't have an event, then I have a correct rejection. So these are the easiest cases to understand. But you see that there's a lot of other cases which can occur. You can get an alarm is given, but the event does not occur. Well, that's bad, right? Suppose you give an alarm for Naples that the Vesuvius breaks out and nothing happens, right? And you have you're in big trouble. So this is the false alarm, say one. But you also can give an alarm, but the event occurs too late. This is also not, you know, it's also a false alarm. So without the tolerance limit here. And you can also give an alarm, but the event occurs too early. So that means you have a missed alarm. You basically missed the event. And you have also a missed alarm when the alarm is not given, but the event occurs. That's also bad. So this is all from those trajectories. You compute all those cases which can occur. And then you can set up a what is called a Pierce skill score. So that's the hit rate minus the false alarm rate. So again, to give an indication, this is 12,000 trajectories getting about, say, 1,900 to each B. And this is what the picture is in terms of your probability PC, that's your critical probability. And here's your sort of mean alarm time. And this is the skill score. So this is hit minus false alarm rate 1. And to give you an example now, if you take, for instance, 0.3, it's a little off, but it should be here. Then you see that if you take a tolerance, say, of 3 days, right, then you have about, say, a score which is 0.5 or so. I think 0.4 is sketchy. It should be a little to the left, with an average, say, time of about 14 days. And you can see, you know, when your tolerance gets to infinity, so you're not interested in the real timing, but just whether it occurs, yes or no, then your skill score goes up, of course. And when you, say, change also, for instance, when you put that to zero, then your skill score goes down, of course, because your event will, you know, will always be with a certain inaccuracy. So it gives you sort of an...
So I'm trying to understand what you are testing exactly. I mean, for instance, have you used the same data to build the statistics for your...
No, this is
transition operator
no,
and,
this is
and for
this
testing
is
it afterwards.
This is a different simulation.
Different simulation.
Yeah, with the same length.
Okay.
Yeah. And so it's the same. Same. Yeah, that's right. That's it's a different simulation.
So then here, are you testing the? I mean, you made several approximations to.
Oh yeah.
For this to work, for instance, the fact that you neglect the memory or these kinds of things. So is it what you are testing now, or are you rather testing the pertinence to have an alarm for this problem?
Yeah, the test is just, you know, how that would it's no testing basically, but yeah, it's testing something. It's testing that the skill score should be bigger than zero, because otherwise you do not better than random, right? So basically, this should be positive, this Pierce skill score, and just showing that. How it depends on say this PC and T alarm. I mean, you can set a very high probability here, for instance, say 0.8. So that gives you in principle can give you a high skill score, but then that's only 1 day ahead, for instance, and that's not very useful. So it just gives you an indication, you know, how you can use this kind of techniques to make a stochastic prediction scheme for the event to occur. Good. So yeah, that was my example. Now to finish off is also interesting. You can also look at it energetically. Why this picture appears in terms of this blocked and zonal state. And so what you do, and you're all familiar with that, you take in this case 8 days. You take the mean over this over 8 day period, and then you look at the fluctuations with respect to the mean. And then you look at the tendency terms for the mean energy, mean kinetic energy, and the fluctuations, and of course this is related to the vinyl stress term, and the rest is just damping, and this is a forcing term. So the psi star is the forcing on the system you put in. And then you can already see that that the regimes here, so the zonal and blocked states, which are the blacked here, they have relatively low, say, fluctuation energy. So this is already a saying that they are, you know, relatively stable in a sense. And the trajectory here, which goes from the zonal to the block state, is sketched here with this, say, very irregular, but it starts in the zonal regime and it ends up in the blocked regime. And then you can basically see what happens if you look at the tendencies here, the EDT, and this is from the tendency from the fluctuations. And this is the Reynolds stress term, and this is the forcing and the dissipation. You see that it goes from the low, say production of eddy of fluctuation energy, let's call it that way. And basically, what happens is that the forcing here, the forcing term, drives it out of the zonal regime. And then at some point here becomes barotropically unstable. You see that here at the terms of the Reynolds stress. And then what basically happens is that the forcing term decreases here, and it drives it basically back here to the blocked state, where you have then here again this relatively low Reynolds stress, so relatively level of instability. So you can follow also along these trajectories in this space. Now you've defined this so almost invariant set, you can sort of look at the energetics of the flow. This is also more extensively described in the notes. Good. So to summarize, this was not the easiest part of the lecture, so I realized that. The others were more easy. But you know, this is a bit more advanced, but you can also handle more complicated systems. And you know all that because you're all working on more or less turbulence, and that's all very complicated. So, so what we I hope to summarize that your reduced transfer operators, which you can apply, of course, in many cases, they learn you about low frequency variability. They show you something about the correlation decay, and if that's oscillatory, whether you have say peaks in the spectrum which are low frequency. It also shows you something about the Markovian part of the reduced dynamics. So that's really basically the projections here. And there's very general techniques for this, like Morisch-Schwanzig approaches, where you can actually you can do that for noisy systems also, and you can get you can isolate the memory when you use projections. And then you see something on the statistical stability. So that's basically how your probability density function is, basically how sensitive it is. And then application to atmospheric variability, as I said, you look at this metastable regimes as almost invariant sets due to this transfer operator approach. And you look at this preferred transition path, which gives you then a prediction scheme. And of course, what you can learn from this also is to look at better model reduction, because I took PC1 and PC3, but that's not, you know, if you take we applied it to ENSO and to another problem where you have an atmospheric, the Plasim model, where maybe Valeria talked about, and you have Plasim model with sea ice, and you get a crisis in the system, so really a crisis where you see the sea ice feedback, where you get, maybe he showed that, I don't know, but already you get a collapse in the sea ice distribution. And for that problem also, it really matters on which observables you take in the reduction. That's not trivial. And the mixing spectrum will give you a very good idea on which are the best observables to do this. And this is also relevant for the Copan approaches and dynamic mode decomposition, where you basically also the observables play a big role in whether it's successful or not in giving you the right, that the reduction gives you actually insight in the behavior of the full system. Good. So at the end, I want to mention, you know, the guy who all did this. I could have done it in the beginning, but this was my PhD student and postdoc, and he's now with Valerio Lucarini in Hamburg. And he wrote his thesis on ergodic theory of climate, which you're interested in, is on the web also, where he applies all these techniques to the different, say, ENSO, and also this PLASIM, and also this atmospheric mode, this atmospheric flow transitions. That's been published. And the other ones take ages because they're submitted a long time ago, but they're going to be published very soon. But they're on archive, all of them, so you can already download them. And this is the more mathematical approach. You see also Michael Chacroun, which you already heard of, I think, from Michael also. is more the theory, and this is the application to delay equations and also to the Einstein-Uhlenbeck process. And then this is basically on this crisis problem. And there's a part three now also, not submitted yet, which is about ENSA. So there's a lot of application now to try to do this reduced transfer operator approaches to learn about, you know, flows which are really resulting from an interaction of all those different modes. So also dynamical systems, but in another way. Good. So nearly at the end, I'd like to thank you. I mean, you were really a fantastic audience. This last talk is a little difficult, I know, but you know, I should tell you this. The other ones were more, I think, more elementary and more easy to follow. But I hope there still will be some questions. And also, I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity here to do this. Fantastic, and also a nice environment. And I'm really curious what comes out this afternoon. I saw a lot of people really working yesterday also, and I heard even that at 10 o'clock in the evening people were still programming, so that I'm really curious. So I'll see that this afternoon.
So I guess there will be many questions. Let's start from here.
So the analysis on blocking and the transfer operator, have you tried it on reanalysis data, although it's much shorter data set?
We tried that, and it doesn't work. You don't have enough data.
But do you have any sense of how much data do you need to get?
That's what I ask the lectures all the time also, you know. Mm-hmm. Can you make an estimate how many data you need? And you can do the analysis, but you see that if you add, you know, you can do that convergence test if you add data, whether the spectrum still changes. And you see a lot of easily spurious spectrum when it changes. And so it's not a pity, because that would have been fantastic to make it really, but it doesn't work. Yeah.
Hello, hello. So if I understood correctly, you suggest to truncate the system to a large number of equations and then to add white noise to all the equations? Or do you not add white noise?
No, this is all deterministic.
Okay.
Except for the part I showed the stochastic half bifurcation to illustrate the mixing spectrum. But the rest from the atmospheric, you know, it's all deterministic. So you solve, basically it's a Liouville type problem in terms of instead of the Fock-Planck equation.
So here you try to use the UF analysis to represent the variability of the atmosphere. I'm wondering if you can switch UFs to the clustered weather regimes and whether the method still works.
You know, I cannot tell you without after doing the memory analysis. So you can do projections in different ways, and then you have to test whether your memory is, whether you have this, whether it's small. So that's all difficult to give you a priori, you know. A priori say, well, these are the best observables. That would be nice, and that's all we're thinking about, but it's not, I don't know that yet. Yeah. It's definitely the case that in this problem with Valeria, which we worked on this PLASA model, that some observables do much better than others. So this is definitely the case. So it makes a big difference, and you can imagine that, you know. It's just this kind of effect here. Yeah.
So you project all the data, I mean, the low order model to several EOF and see there's some kind of cluster features and can be considered.
Be careful. We don't use a low order model.
Yeah.
We look at the statistics and then we do space.
Yeah. Well, I guess my question is, I mean, there's a technique called singular spectral analysis, which actually is doing similar thing and do the embedding and sort of eventually project onto maybe three eigenvectors and that works pretty well for the Lorentz model. You can use just one tiny bit of data and reconstruct the construct attractor pretty well. Yeah. So it seems pretty relevant to this problem, and you can do a similar.
But the MSA mode would only be, you know, that would be equivalent to the step of the EOF reduction. Then still in this MSSA basis, or yeah, you do have to have MSSA here, you still have to do the transfer operator estimation because you want to look at propagation of probability density. So the MSSA, indeed, I mean, it looks a lot like EOFs, of course, when the patterns are stationary. And even when they're propagating, they overlap because you take lag correlations instead of EOF where you don't take lag correlations. So that's the advantage. But indeed, it could be that the MSSA basis, you know, for some problems would be better in terms of estimating the transfer operator. But again, it's the same problem as I for the previous question. You have no, you know, a priori knowledge yet and on what is the best way of reducing the data. So what you take as observables. Yeah. So that's open. You know. Yeah.
Can you reduce memory by taking an observable that is also has space and time in it, sort of a instead of just taking space and using time to calculate a transfer operator, you take a block of time as well in along with just spatial dimensions.
Yeah, so maybe. Yeah, again, I would say that depends really on the system also. How you, it's better maybe to think from the physics point of view, how what observables to take. It's probably better to or making some a priori estimates of phase plots or so, and where the attractor is located. I mean, I think that that's you can do quite an efficient pre-study maybe to look at what are the best observables, and that could be something like this. Yeah, I mean. Although, remember, this is all, you know, still all equilibrium. And the transfer operator will give you the propagation of the probabilities on the attractor. So that's a, this is also a drawback. If you force the system and you go out of the attractor, this is what this the transfer operator doesn't tell you anything about it. So that's additional theory. It's still, you know, Valerio is working on that, and Alexis also with Valerio, how to do that. And we submitted a paper on the Lorentz system. It's not here on how you can distinguish those features, but on the attractor, yeah, probably it's easier to design the observables than even when you add the forcing. Yeah.
When we speak about those preferred transition paths,
yeah,
that kind of reminds me of Valerio's talk where he talked about those edge states that are most likely to be crossed when you go from one attractor to the other.
Yeah.
Is this related in any way, or?
In the plasim, I don't know which example he had, but maybe the plasim also, that's related, yes. Yes. So you had also this preferred paths through the edge stage, yeah. Did he show plasim? I wasn't there. Yeah, I think so, eh? Because that's the example he has, yeah. Yeah, it's also the edge stage. I mean, they're also in the Passai flow, right? There are many of those examples where you see edge stage in terms of stability of the Passai flow. Yeah, this is what Bruno Eckhardt and company have worked on for a long time. Yeah, of course, yeah.
Well, in model where you have a small noise, for instance, or when you can make the reduction when the reduction is actually exact because you have a small parameter which are specific and probably do not apply to the Earth atmosphere, then the fact that the transition goes through a single path is well understood for decades in statistical physics. It's called the instanton theory.
So I got a question, one to link back to your first talk, actually. We defined the null hypothesis for the climate, and it seems to rest spectrum era one pulses. Is that the background spectrum we get if we take all the reconstruction data and plot it in one time series and do a power spectrum analysis? In other words,
over all, you know, time scales.
In other words, you show this cartoon figure, and we seem to focus on the spectral peaks that exceeds the background.
No. It looks, you know, people have done this, Peter Huybers, and it looks, you know, very complicated. Different exponents. If you add, you know, paleo proxy time series and present day, There's a paper by Peter Hybels and some other looking at, and also a work of Sean Lovejoy. It looks very different. So that's also, I was careful with the null hypothesis, applies to SST variability, right? In the ocean. So this is much more complicated, and that picture is you see features in there, changes in power law behavior, etc. But then to understand, you know, where that comes from, because it's not all noise. There's also, you know, Dansk-Odersk events, there's Pleistocene ice ages, there's they even go back in time to deep time series. So that's not only noise driven, you know, in the system.
So I may ask you a question myself. So first I want to say that I find this last lecture very interesting. I mean, the method is probably the most promising in in terms of studying these complex dynamical systems when there is no timescale separation. So I will ask the same question as before, but maybe a bit more precise. So you are not able to do that from the data yet. But maybe there is a simpler question. Here you have a bimodal distribution for when you look at the PDF in the PC1, PC3. Mm-hmm. So do you have such a bimodal distribution from the data? So or from a more complex GCM?
Maybe Ted knows better. I'm not sure whether there is really bimodality there. If you look at the data, I mean, it looks fairly Gaussian, actually. So this is also, you know, it's. But maybe other people, I know, you have more experts here. I
can't say for the blocking per se, but I know that, for example, Cecile Penland and Prashant Sarjeswaran and so on, they definitely are looking for this sort of thing in bimodal, but or something. But I can't speak specifically for. But I would have thought they would have looked at blocking because that's the sort of thing they're interested in, the climate variability. But I wouldn't want to. But that would be the place to look, probably.
Yeah. There are papers on this, but I don't think it's so very clear in the atmosphere from the data whether you have a, you know, nice bimodal type of spectrum.
Okay, so I think now it's time to thanks again, Anke. It was a really great lecture.